We are the paradoxical ape. Bipedal, naked, large-brained, long the master of fire, tools, and language, but still trying to understand ourselves. Aware that death is inevitable, yet filled with optimism. We grow up slowly. We hand down knowledge. We empathize and deceive. We shape the future from our shared understanding of the past. CARTA brings together experts from diverse disciplines to exchange insights on who we are and how we got here. An exploration made possible by the generosity of humans like you.
Thank you very much. What I want to talk about is dealing with the organization of human society and the nature of human society. And I believe that if we think of it in general evolutionary terms, we see that the organization of human society is really quite different to that of our nearest primate cousins, the chimpanzees. I think the results of that difference are clear, and there are two. One of them is that we are able to build up societies of far greater size than we find among any other close primates, and greater complexity. And the second one is that we think of our social organization as lasting far, far longer than the life of the people who might be part of that society. I believe that both these differences are due to the fact that many aspects of human society are imaginary. And therefore, I'm going to start to look at imagination in a certain amount of detail. The notion of imagination is very often linked with creativity, and quite rightly. And it's also linked with individual creation. That's not what I will be talking about. I'll be talking about something quite different, which is shared imagination. How the same imaginary features are shared within a group. And how that comes about is due to a number of factors. But I think already, if we remember the slide we've seen about pretend play, we can see that both there seems to be a general predispositions in humans for pretend play. But that pretend play gets slot in with things which are instituted within the culture and the society of people who are doing this pretend play. So I think we have to think of predispositions enabling us to take on historically created structures like schools was obvious in the last picture in that series about pretend play. We have to think of this articulation between the two kinds of things. So what I'll be talking about is not individual imagination, though obviously it's involved, but the sharing of imagination. And let me go back to what I started off with. Saying that there are many aspects of human social organization which have to be imaginary. The first factor of this, which I want to talk about, is the notions of the groups we often think we belong to. Let me start off with examples of clans, which we find in various forms in many human societies. Now, one of the interesting things about humans, about clans, is that they're thought of as lasting in time far longer than the life span of individuals. That already means that they have to be imaginary, because obviously if they were attached to the individuals, they would sort of end or have no great continuity. But this would also be true of nations. For example, one can think of the Greeks as a nation, quite apart from their territory, having gone on for very, very long periods in time. The Greeks continued, they passed on from one another something called vague Greekishness, though it's very difficult to define what that might be, and very interestingly, it's very difficult even for the people who think this is extremely important to define it. So, again, we imagine, and I think I can use the word, that there is a level at which the social continues on a quite different time scale than the life, our biological life. That doesn't mean, and there is another factor which is even more important. We continually think of as a very important part of our society is that we have instituted roles. Husband, wife, to use an example which was used by the philosopher Searle, but policeman, and so on. Now, there's something rather odd about these roles, because they don't seem to have very little to do with what people actually get up to. People may hate each other, husbands and wives may hate each other, but we think that there is something about them being husband and wife independently of this. So if we think of our society as systems of roles, as large numbers of roles, we realize that we have to think on another level, on an imaginary level, other than the interactions, which has been the greatest focus in psychology when people are thinking of the social. We have to think of how it is possible that these systems, there are shared systems of the social which don't correspond to anything empirical. I should have mentioned when I was talking about clans, that clans, you know, people can imagine themselves as belonging to clans without anything obvious marking them out from people who belong to other clans, that they usually do not live together, that they're dispersed, yet somehow there is a level, an imaginary level, at which people can think of themselves as one. So this really presents, this is something which we do not find in any other primates. This is why I would argue that that we should stop thinking of human society as a sort of incremental business of getting better and better and knowing other people and knowing the world. There is also a discontinuity, which means that, which I would identify with the presence of that imagination. Having said that, however, this presents a problem. How, for what I started off with talking about, which is that I was saying that something very different about human societies, that they seem to be able to be expanded to extraordinarily large size in a way that doesn't apply to other primates. And there's also this idea of them continuing in time. Of course, this is not a problem if by society we mean these imaginary representations that I was talking about. They can be as large as you like, or as indeed they're systems which are not tied to particular moments. But I was talking about practical results. How can this imaginary level have practical results, which are tremendously important if we want to understand the evolution of human society? I think the answer comes from the fact that this imaginary level is not as imaginary as it might seem at first. There are what I've called emergences, that is, moments when the shared imagination is actually acted out, where people can live in the shared imagination as well as they live in the practical interactional world, which is normal, sort of everyday level. These are very largely rituals which involve people losing many of the aspects of themselves as individuals, in that what characterizes rituals are their repetitions of previous, people say the same thing as other people have said. They therefore lose their intentionality. They become kind of elements in an abstract structure, but it is acted out. And at other moments, in normal life, or in normal traditional life, people step in and out of the imaginary level to an interactional level, and they're able to hold two quite different ways of thinking about society. This is what is not found in other primates. And this has practical results. For example, if you imagine yourself living in a Neolithic village and you want to set up move to another village, you have to move to this imaginary level in order to be able to build up kinship relationships with other people in that other village, convince them that somehow there is something in common, and that is moving to another level, to that imaginary level, and then you can move to that sort of place. This, I think, explains how pre-state humans managed to have very far-reaching and distant trading relationships. And also to the other practical level, to the other practical factor, which is imagining that your society lasts in time, that somehow we can imagine that we have a social which lasts in time quite independently of our biological life. It means that there is some point in, first of all, in passing on and accumulating either objects, because we are passing them on to people who we don't know, who are our continuation, but only in imagination, and perhaps passing on knowledge, which then becomes the basis of what the evolutionary biologist Michael Tomasello has called the Wretched Effect, that is, building up on knowledge which is already there so that it can then be used for ever more complex systems. This is basically the ability in human culture to continue and to accumulate and to advance. So the possibility of stepping in to moments of what is normally shared imagination explains, I think, the most fundamental differences between our society and the society of, let us say, chimpanzees. Thank you.